Very good afternoon. Today I'm going to do a little different presentation. I'm going to try to use some of my favorite stories and some of my favorite music to try and illustrate what are the important things for a new paradigm in leadership. And so this story is going to begin with some music, and then we will talk about trying to bring it all together, and then you can ask me some questions. Of years ago, India was a center of progress. People came to trade in silks. They came to trade in spices. And if you ask me at that time, India was the best in the world. The time of the Mughal Empire, everybody thought the best in art, the best in architecture, the best in food, the best in culture, the best in music and poetry were all in India. At that time, it even surpassed the great Mediterranean culture. But one important thing happened, and that was that India was very inward-looking. You know, everybody came to India, but no Mughal king ever sent somebody outside India, whereas people traveled from all over the world to see what we were doing. So in 1497, European presence changed life irrevocably. It is a story of exploration and exploitation. It is a story of brutality, of betrayal, of colonial ambition. And this is echoes of this distant past that we are going to discuss this afternoon. This tapestry of history is also the foundation for our future. Inside this is a treasure chest of stories, lessons learned, sometimes forgotten. In Indian culture, we have a treasure trove of stories which have imaginative power. They become alive, forgotten strengths, wisdom in darkness, hope, courage for life, and universal values. So I'm going to tell you about crumbling empires, cannons and kings, knight errands and his lady of great dreams, a quest for the impossible, a genius, a bird, a frail man facing the might of an empire, and so on. So once upon a time, there were many stories. My first story is the empires of the monsoon, and then I'm going to talk a few minutes about other stories to then in the end bring you why I feel that this are the core of what is a new leadership. When Europe started looking for a new route to India to outflank Islam's barrier, a tiny nation makes an epic voyage. And so, you all know the story of Vasco da Gama, how he rounded the Cape at Mozambique, and there he saw four Arab dhows. He was overcome with joy. At last, the riches of India were within his reach, and a life as immutable as the coming and going of the monsoon was about to vanish. The Portuguese made a breach through which the jackals raced to get their fills, and Portuguese caravels land in Calicut. The date was 18th May 1498. Da Gama fulfilled his destiny after the longest voyage in sea history. He was ready for the most powerful ruler on the Indian coast, his name, Zamorin, Raja of Calicut. And then what happened? Can you imagine this scene where Vasco da Gama walks up to the Zamorin? He has come on a very long voyage, but he has nothing, he has no money. So he presents the Zamorin with a big basket of hats instead of money. So the Zamorin is very offended. He says, show me the color of your money, otherwise I can't give you spices. And then the Zamorin puts Vasco da Gama in jail. For a man of such a violent temper, the change in Vasco da Gama was amazing. The next time, he brought his ships and loaded them with guns. And then he blasted Calicut with gunpowder in his cannons for 3 whole days. Now, my point here is, as I said, that the Mughal Empire had the best in the world. But here, what happened? We forgot the invention of gunpowder. It was a moment in history where science overcame the whole idea of dynasty, the whole idea of a country. We had forgotten what is gunpowder. And so Vasco da Gama loaded his cannons with gunpowder, blasted Calicut for 3 days. The ancient roots were changed forever. The colonial invasion grew for the next 400 years. Imagine that you are living in that era. Your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, and your great-great-grandchildren would not be free. They would be like a caged bird, a bird in a cage, not free because of the colonial invasion. All because we forgot the invention of gunpowder. So what was the message of my story? Bha means radiance, Ratha means revel. That country which revels in knowledge, the land where people revel in knowledge. And yet, we were inward looking. We forgot one of the greatest discoveries of science. We suffered for 400 years because we were not outward looking, we were inward looking. And so, in the next millennium, if India is to become the greatest, we have to look outward. Our children are going to universities abroad, we are all traveling. Yes, but are we absorbing technologies? Are we spending on R&D? Are we looking at new discoveries which no one has ever seen before? And I think our country lacks that. And that is why that is my message of the empires of the monsoon. You look at what happened in the Gateway, marked the arrival of King George when the British Empire came to our country. So my next story is called The Frail One. It is one that you know well. England was the greatest empire the world has ever known at that time. And courage, Ralph Waldo Emerson says, whatever you do, you need courage. Whatever course you decide on, there's always someone to tell you it can't be done. How many times you have faced that in your career, where people said, not possible, can't be done, very difficult, too much competition, you have it. So to find courage to do what you believe in, that is really important, said Emerson. If you look at the story of Gandhi, he spent 2,000 days in jail, several times a fast unto death. And he was a very tiny man. He was not some charismatic, good-looking individual. He was only 114 pounds. He had really funny ears. Nature had meant his face to be ugly. He was an unlikely revolutionary. He was so gentle. He didn't get up and have guns. He didn't get up and have power. And so this story, I think, really moves me.
Last night at midnight, they took Gandhiji from us. They expect us to lose heart or to fight back. We will do neither.
No, sir, the gate is closed.
They walked, both Hindu and Muslim alike, with heads held high, without any hope of escape from injury or death. It went on and on into the night. Stop. Women carried the wounded and broken bodies from the road until they dropped from exhaustion. Stop. But still, it went on and on. Stop.
So this was an unlikely revolutionary who changed the course of the whole world. The honor of India, he said, is symbolized by some salt. Who would have thought about that, that something like salt could be so powerful? And Roosevelt said, it is better to dare mighty things, to win glorious triumphs, even though you have failure. I think in the lives of women, there have to be sometimes when it is life is very difficult, where there is failure. And we are always told that we can't manage it, we can't do it. I think I was thrown out of a number of male-oriented organizations because they felt they didn't believe that I could even achieve what I wanted to do. And so this is a very common thing which you will see. So amidst all this, Gandhi had values, the value of courage. And so that is my second message, that the value of courage is very important in the new paradigm of leadership. My third story is called The Quest. It is set in 16th century in Spain in the Spanish Inquisition. Miguel Cervantes was a prisoner and other prisoners attacked him. But he said, listen, I'm a poet, why are you attacking me? But they burnt his manuscript, made him undergo a trial. And then he wrote this book, the wonderful book called The Man of La Mancha. Enter my imagination. And he becomes a knight called Don Quixote La Mancha. Here is his story.
Hear me now, thou bleak and unbearable world. Thou art base and debauched as can be. And the knight with his banners all bravely unfurled now hurls down his gauntlet to thee. I, Don Quixote, the Lord of La Mancha. My destiny calls and I go. And the wild winds of fortune will carry me onward, oh, whithersoever they blow.
So Quixote entered this inn where he found Aldonza, lady of easy virtue. But she had this nobility of spirit. And he follows an impossible dream, brawls over, wins over a gang. And he says a man can do anything if he has to hold moonlight in his hand. And when death is near, Aldonza reminds him of his dream, the impossible dream. To me, that is one of the most important sectors of the paradigm of leadership, where the idea, the real vision of an impossible dream comes to all of us.
It is the mission of each true knight, his duty, nay, his privilege. To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love you and chase from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest. Follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest.
And so one man
will be
made a difference
for this, that when men scorned and covered with scars, still strong with his last ounce of courage,
so everybody can make a difference. With your thoughts, you can create the world, and you can be an unstoppable person if you have that unreachable star. So to strive, to seek, and not to yield creates frontiers which are limitless, which nobody has thought of before. So that one moment when you commit yourself to reaching this unreachable star, actually the providence moves too, and you can, whatever you can dream, you can begin it. So the Upanishad said the best, I think. You are what your deep driving desire is. As your desire is, so is your will. So is your will, so is your deed. As your deed is, so is your destiny. Many people say, mere naseeb mein nahi hai. But no, the naseeb moves when you move it too. So my fourth story is called The Man Who Saw Infinity. It is a story of a young man born in a small house in Erode, some 440 kilometers from Chennai. When he was a small boy, he entered the school called in Kumbakonam, and he started to read books on mathematics. He was very spiritual, but he was very poor. And he wrote to the goddess Namakkal, and he wrote his formulae in his dreams. One day, he sent his formulae to Cambridge University to a scientist called Hardy in January of 1913. He said, I'm a Hindu clerk called Ramanujan. I'm very poor. I don't have money to eat. But Hardy looked at his theorems and threw them in the waste paper basket. He said, there's no good. It doesn't matter. But in the middle of the night, he woke up and said, my gosh, these theorems have something of great value to humanity. And these 120 theorems, when Hardy tried to solve, it took him the whole night. So only a mathematician of highest class could have written it. An incredible skill was needed to write the theorems. So Ramanujan sailed from India on the 17th of March in 1914. Srinivas Ramanujan was one of India's greatest mathematical geniuses. But he didn't think, he said, like a European. Hardy said, you know, he thinks like an Indian. And that is my point of this story. We don't have to think like Americans. We don't have to think like Europeans. We have to think like Indians, because that can give you the limitless possibility of new ideas. And so Ramanujan showed us the way that India will recognize him as a treasure, said Hardy, and that he has no equal in this whole century. So that became one of the other paradigms of leadership, that you can really think about your own country and your own genius. So his message to us is nurture our unique Indian way of thinking. Books are the center of knowledge, make them your friends. Persevere despite great odds and prove that you can compete with the best in the world. So finally, I want to tell you a story about the Ministry of Crows. Now what happened one day, I was having dinner at my home and I had a person from another country, and on my windowsill there were these crows. So he says, you know, in my country, we have something called the Ministry of Crows, and their job is to take a gun and shoot every crow that they can. Why? Because the crows are very irritating. They're, you know, they eat from garbage cans. So I started to think, ye desh mein crow jo hai, wo maar rahe hai. And then I looked up our own culture and I said, you know, the crow was Krishna's friend. It is in poetry, it is in song, it is in... And then I looked up some further scientific facts. Crows are amazing. They have this cooperative defense behavior, which no other bird has. They're highly social. They're constantly talking to each other. This caw, caw, caw is actually a strategy for success. They have the largest brains in relation to their body. And you know what? They don't need wildlife sanctuaries like Ranthambore to survive, right? They work in the dustbins outside Mumbai city. Bombay Municipal Corporation is their wildlife paradise, right? And they will eat anything. One day outside my window, I saw this crow circle. And that's a very rare gift, crows, when they are walking together. It is a gift of spiritual knowledge which is recognized in our culture, is recognized in our music.
They live in you. They live in me. They're watching over everything we see. In every creature, in every star, in your reflection, they live in you.
So they are our reflection. And that is the message of the crow. Open your eyes and see. Feel the world as if it's a living flute. Feel the meeting of creative joy in the depth of consciousness. But if you sit away from the barrier to creation, you will not be able to see why is that creative instinct. Meet this morning light in the majesty of your existence, said Tagore. So when I talked about how all these things affected my whole life, I began to start doing science about 11 years ago, when the Nobel Prize winners, you see, Sir Paul Nurse, discovered a new enzyme. And we at the Piramal Life Sciences Institute, which is only 15 minutes away from here, began to work in this area. And you know what? Everybody told me, you can't be doing it. The whole of India, everybody is very good at copying. We can't invent anything. We don't know how to innovate. We don't know how to file a patent. Whatever work we do will never be accepted by UK and USA, and all that work we are doing is very shoddy. And that we really have no innovative thinking. And there is no scope for innovation. I was thrown out of a very male-oriented organization called the Indian Pharmaceutical Industry because I said, no, I think Indian scientists can innovate. And they said, no. Look, we are very good at copying, the price is low, that's what we are going to do. And I was summarily thrown out of the place because nobody believed that we can do this. So today, what is the story? I think we are very near to that top of the mountain. It's been 10 years. But we've actually found a drug from whatever the Nobel Prize winner discovered, and then found a new drug which acted on those enzymes. And in fact, tomorrow I'm going to Delhi to try and present this to our regulatory authorities as a new drug from India, patented in 200 countries. And it will be available for Indian patients at a very affordable cost. Yes, it was a mountain. From 5 scientists, we had 100 working on it. Nobody believed that this can be done. And still, I feel that the mindset has to change, that India can innovate, India can think about it, India will accept that this work is done for the benefit of patients. And so not only do I have one drug, I have 250 patents. I have all these drugs which are in different phases of clinical trials. It's accepted in 5 continents, including the US, UK, New Zealand, Australia, Japan, Europe. And so I really think that in the next few years, India will be the leader in innovation. And if we are to form this paradigm of leadership, if we are to take the leadership in the world, what does it need? And here in this graph, I've kind of put together everything that I talked about. One, you have to have an impossible dream. 11 years ago, when I started discovery of drugs, everybody said, it's impossible. It can't be done. They said, not possible. Whenever I spoke to some conference, people laughed and said, she doesn't really know what she's talking about. So you have to have this impossible dream, this deep desire, this destiny. You have to be outward looking. You have to see what's going around the world. You have to have positive thinking. You have to have perseverance and courage, like what you saw Ramanujan had, like the courage that Gandhiji showed, the faith that he had. And most important in all this, you have to show that you have a purpose in life. This Swadharma, for me, it was to reduce the burden of disease, to find a drug which could help the pain of the people. That was my dream. That was my thought that maybe in the 10 years that I work, can I find something that will reduce the pain of people, that will help them cure cancer, that will go against diabetes, which is such a big disease, 50 million people in my country already affected by it. And so you have to have a purpose in life. And if you have all this, in the end, you find what I call Swadharma. And finding that Swadharma, I think that's the source of Stri Shakti, the source, the central, the core of humanity, the core of yourself, when you find your Swadharma. Because when you can find it, which is based on the strong values that it is not doing the wrong thing, it is doing the right thing, it is working with integrity, it is working with sincerity, I think that we women have more than everybody else. We really do everything very much with integrity and with sincerity because that is what we teach our children. And so if we have all these values, I think that you can win. You can find the core of what I call Sri Sakti. So I want to play for you to end the most beautiful anthem which I discovered quite by accident. It was written by Rabindranath Tagore when he opened a research center of Sir Jagdish Bose in 1917. And he perhaps wrote it at the same time as he wrote our national anthem. So you will feel that the notes are similar. But he wrote it for scientists. He said, please, your knowledge must take away ignorance. Your knowledge, you must have victory for this knowledge. And so I think it's one of the most beautiful pieces of music. It is sung by Pandit Jasraj. It has now become a national science. 1917,
Tagore wrote a poem for the inauguration of the Bose Research Institute. He wrote the famous song, Matri Mandira Punya Angana, brighten the courtyard of the temple of your motherland. In the song Matri Mandir, Tagore speaks of a gathering of the greatest minds in the temple of science, gladdening the heart of the motherland, banishing the darkness of ignorance with the light of knowledge, and working for the perfection of the spirit of man and a universal humanity. To celebrate the inauguration of the new Nicholas Piramal Research Center by the Honorable President of India, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, on November the 18th, 2004, in Mumbai, we present Science Anthem.
Shadi, aao asi maao. वो सूरज है चमकता कर्म भूमि सजाओ रे दम साहस कर्म सत्य जग का मन जीत जाओ रे
शंख गूंजे जाए
मानव की जय मानवता की जय हो तपस्या की